Isn't that fun? Watching the kids. Well, happy Easter, everybody. So glad to have you here. This is our third service today, and it's so good to see so many faces. I'm grateful for all of you who are joining us online, but I'm really grateful. I'm really grateful for both, okay? But it just feels really nice to be back with people in a church service where we can look at each other's faces. I know increasing numbers of us are getting fully vaccinated, and it feels like, yes, we can go back to life, and it's such a good thing. I wanted to show you that video that you just saw about the children, because I want to talk to you about something that I'm afraid, if we don't talk about it, that our understanding might just stay at a children's level. Here's what I mean by that. Even little children understand about Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. I mean, they can say the right things that kind of just blow you away. We have a four-year-old grandson, and my wife was telling me what he was saying about the resurrection, and it's like, wow, you know, at such an early age to be able to articulate and say these things. And my hunch is, if I asked most of you, can you articulate what Easter is about, what Good Friday is about, you'd be able to articulate it. But I wonder how much we really grasp it and understand it. Here's what I mean. I think that we all, every one of us, are living lives, and we're living lives without an active awareness of the root problems in life and the root solutions to those problems. So the Jesus story, the resurrection story, it makes no sense as the focus of life, as the focus of your life, unless we first presume the depth of the problem. In other words, if there's this great solution, what's the great solution to? Well, the great solution is to your biggest problems. And I'm talking to you, and I'm talking to me, and I want us to talk about what's really going on. Now, let's clear the fog here a little bit. You know, it's just true of human beings that we all want to be good people. I want to be a good person, you want to be a good person. Man or woman, there's some debate in our society right now about what is a good person. On a basic level, you know, you just genuinely want to be the kind of person who when you say yes, you mean yes. When you say no, you mean no. If we asked you, you want to be good. And here's the thing, folks. Most of us think that we're good. Most of us think that we're pretty good people. In fact, we live our lives, I guess in some ways, it would just cause tremendous upset if we fully grasped our real sin nature. The truth of the matter is, when you fully grasp it, it's hard. It's hard to face yourself when you really grasp who God is and what's in your heart and in mine. I would say my biggest problem every day when I get up is the person I look in the mirror and see, because I don't always live the way I want to live. Now, before we get there, though, let's talk just a little bit about what it means to be a good person, because a lot of us have ideas today about what it is to be a good person, and it affects the way we look at church. And more people are getting sidetracked about what church is really about and what this community called the Christian community is really focused on. So when we talk about being a good person, people want to be good people, okay? Now, there's a whole generation that's become very aware of the importance of social justice. And so we define being a good person as caring about the marginalized and the hurting. And this is a good thing. We want to care about racial issues. Our country, in fact, has become so aware of it. And it's a real blessing to learn about how people of different races can often live their entire lives feeling put down and misunderstood and mistreated. And we should care about that, and we should try to live in light of that. More and more, we're becoming aware of how women are often mistreated, and of the great sin of misogyny and of mistreating women. And those are good things. Those are things we should be concerned about, especially, you know, those of us who we know women that we love and care about who've not always been treated right. And then in our families, who wants to be a good father? Who wants to be a good mother? Who wants to be a good child or a good sibling? You want to, right? You want to do good at school. You want to be a good person. It's put in you. But let me just tell you, I don't care who you are and how you define being good, we all fall short. I was thinking recently, you know, they call it cancel culture, where if they catch you that you've said something, even if it was 10 years ago, on social media, they can pull it up and you get fired and lose your job. And I was thinking about myself and I thought, man, if somebody went back through my life and they picked out everything that I'd done wrong, I'd not only like get canceled, I'd get sent to jail or something. Because, you know, when you really look at what you've done wrong, and it's true probably for you too, if somebody really knew the secret thoughts that were in your heart. So what is it that we have to wrestle with when we're all trying to be this person? I want to get to my next slide because it's not coming, that we all fall short. So I'm just going to tell you, even though I can't get the slide there. Oh, there we go. Thanks, somebody back there for helping me. So I just want to say, there is a God, and God knows all of our thoughts. He knows everything we think, everything we say, everything we do. God knows us all. And I have a problem and you have a problem. That is, we have a sin nature. So when you think about God and you think about yourself, you cannot understand the basics unless you understand you do wrong, I do wrong. That's a problem. It's a problem between you, me, and God. Okay? Now, most of us tend to minimize it. Now, I do want to pause here for a second because some people don't minimize it. You maximize it. And you feel your life is one where you feel shame. You have a hard time even having any hope for yourself because you just feel like a failure. And if anybody is in that situation right now and you hear my voice, I just want you to hear how much God loves you. And we, none of us are ever so bad that we would fall beyond God's love, care, and redemption. And if you are racked by shame and you've done terrible things, I just want you to know that God does love us, and that's why he sent Jesus. Most of us, we have the opposite problem. We minimize our sins. We act like we're not that bad. And sin is something out there that other people do. It's Adolf Hitler, and it's people like that. Or you may have seen this past week, the Satan shoes. How many people heard about the Satan shoes? Make sure I say his name right, Lil Nas X. So he's got the Satan shoes. They came out. By the way, in 2019, he spent the longest the song was ever the top song in the country on the Billboard Hot 100. It was his song in 2019. And so he comes out with these shoes, 666. He sold 666 of them for $1,000. And they were sold out within a minute. And if you were watching the internet, people were going nuts about it, how this kind of thing could happen and how terrible it is. But then somebody pointed out, it was 43 years ago, Kiss, the group Kiss, that they took their blood and they mixed it with ink and came out with a Marvel comic strip of Kiss. And, you know, it was even being said back then. And here's the thing about it. It's so easy to point out that sin's out there and it's something somebody else was doing, when the reality is my biggest concern is what I'm doing and your biggest concern is what you're doing, because sin goes deep through our heart. And that's the thing we have to realize, is that we have this big problem. You may have seen the Chick-fil-A answer to the response. My pleasure. No. So let's talk just a little bit about that, though, if we can, for a second. Because we all want to physically live, and we all want to somehow deal with our sin. Now, I want to tell you a story about your sin before I go too far here, though, before I start talking about what it means to die. So please hear me on this. There are a lot of people who think you can be a good person without God. Now, let's note this. We can live good moral lives on one level without God. But I want to tell you a story. There was a woman who, she was a single mom. She wasn't very wealthy, but she loved her son. And she raised him to be honest, to always tell the truth, to work hard, to give to the poor, and live a good life. And as she raised him, she was able to scrimp together personally enough money to send him to college. So he went to college and she paid for it. And she was so happy on the day of his graduation when he graduated from college. But do you know what happened after he graduated from college? He never talked to her again. He sent her a card at Christmas. He would not call her. He would not respond to her phone calls. He would not respond to her letters. He had nothing to do with her the rest of her life. Was he a good man? When the one who had given him life itself and every good thing, he ignored. That is no different than somebody living their lives being a good person while neglecting or rejecting God. Now, let's talk about the second problem. The first problem, the first core problem, is our sin. Our second problem is that we're all going to die. I'm going to die, you're going to die, we're all going to die. I just recently had a birthday, and somebody said, well, you're not that old. And I know I'm not that old, but I feel like I'm getting older. Because you become more aware of the wrinkles on your forehead and on your face. And here's the reality. My mom used to, I remember when my mom was in her 50s, and she said, Bobby, everybody in their 20s looks really good. And I started thinking to myself, she was right. When you're in your 20s, pretty much everybody looks good. I know not everybody, but you know the point, because you're full of life. And we want to live. We want to enjoy life and be successful and enjoy all the good things that God has given to us. I mean, and there are such good things in life. How many people saw the end of the Gonzaga basketball game last night, where as the buzzer goes, the three-pointer goes in, and they win and make it to the finals, right? I mean, talk about celebration of life. I have these friends, and I saw the video that they had of it, and they were like, they're just full of life and alive, and that's what we want. We want to live. We want to live, but we're all going to die. And we tend to live our lives without the full awareness of death that people who've gone before us had, right? Because we're living longer, and when people get sick, they go to the hospital. When they get really sick and they're going to die, they go to the hospital, and then they die, but we don't see them typically. We just hear that they've died. So we're not as used to people like people have been throughout history, where death was just a part of our lives, and people live and people die, and you automatically think you got these two things going on. You got the problem with sin nature, you got the problem that we don't live the way we're supposed to live, but we want to live better, and you have the problem that we're all going to die. Eventually, everybody is going to die until Jesus, if Jesus comes back first, that's the only way we're not going to die. So what do I do about my two problems? And I just want to say, you can explore all the religions in the world. You can look at Buddhism. You can look at Islam. You can look at Hinduism. You can look at Judaism. They don't deal the same way as Christianity does, and where Christianity and our faith in Jesus says, these are our two most fundamental problems. I want to be good, but I'm not. I want to live. I want to live forever. I want to have joy. I want to experience utopia. I want to enjoy relationships. I want to enjoy God's creation. I want to enjoy God, but I'm going to die. And Christianity says, Jesus Christ loves us so much, he came into the world to provide the solution. Now, because we're in such a death-denying culture, let me talk frankly with you about this. So probably one of the most well-respected Christian writers and leaders today is Timothy Keller. About a year ago, he wrote a book called On Death. And the book was about to come out, and he was coming back from the Far East, and he went in to the doctor because he was having some intestinal problems, and they found out he's got pancreatic cancer, which is not a good cancer. And so he published this article about 30 days ago in the Atlantic magazine. And here's what he said. growing my faith in the face of death, I spent a lifetime counseling others before my diagnosis. He talked about how easy it was to talk to other people who were dying and somehow think, well, that doesn't apply to me. He said he got the diagnosis and he came home and his book arrived, where he had written a book on dying. He said this. He said, my wife and I were both turning 70. We felt strong, we were clear-minded, and we were capable of, we thought we'd be continue to be capable of doing what we've done for the last 50 years. But all of a sudden, the reality came crashing in. And here's what Keller himself said. I found myself thinking, what? No, I can't die. That happens to others, not to me. And I just want to say, we tend to live our lives that way. We tend to live our lives. You tend to live your life not being fully aware of how your sin makes you fall short of God and how you're going to die. And when we die, our life is over. So anything that we want to be about has to deal at root, first and foremost, with these two issues. From one human being to another, I just appeal to you. And so the Apostle Paul addresses us in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And what he is going to do is he's going to show us how our core problems require core solutions. And here's what he says. This is a beautiful passage. This is the most beautiful passage you could ever imagine in the Bible. This whole chapter on how God is good news, how Jesus Christ brings good news. It begins this way in verse 1. Now, brothers and sisters, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you received and on which you've taken your stand. So Paul starts off and he says, I want to remind you of the gospel. It's a Greek word, euangelion. It simply means good news. Here's what the gospel was in the ancient world. Something happened, and because of that thing that happened, everything has now changed. Well, here's what happened. Jesus Christ came into the world. He died on the cross. He was buried. He rose from the dead. He's exalted to the Father. That happened, and because that happened, everything's different now. There's a solution, as we're going to see. There's a solution to my problem with myself. There's a solution to my aspiration to live, to enjoy life, to enjoy relationships, to enjoy fulfillment. There's a solution where I can do that now forever and ever and ever. That's the gospel. Now, he says this. This gospel is so important. It is the thing on which you have taken your stand. We do not take our stand that we are good people. We do not take our stand that we have a church with great music, great programs, great preaching, great teaching. We don't take our stand on those things. We take our stand, Scripture teaches, on the gospel and on nothing else. By this gospel, he goes on and says, you are saved. If you hold firmly to the word I preached to you, otherwise you've believed in vain. How important is the gospel? The gospel is so important that you take your stand on it, and by that gospel, you are made right with God. You are saved. Your sins are taken away, and your body itself will be saved. And as if to add underline to underline, he then says this, for what I received, Paul says, I passed on to you as of first importance. How important is that? How important is this stuff? How important is it for you? Like, in your heart of hearts, do you cherish this? Is this what you build your life around? Is this all of your hopes and aspirations and all of your desires and how you deal with your own sense of weakness and frailty? When you see the wrinkles that emerge, when you have fear at night or fear in the day, or when you wonder about your life, do you come back and do you say, I trust not just Jesus, I trust the gospel of Jesus Christ. Paul goes on and describes the gospel. It's a short summary description of it. Christ died for our sins. First thing, out of the chute, Jesus died for our sins according to the scriptures. So there's a whole Old Testament story to that that he doesn't unpack, but he refers to here. Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. He was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. Now, the resurrection is so important for the sense of death, because in the Old Testament, when God had the people bring in animals and they slit the throat of the animal and they took the blood of the animal and they poured out the blood on the altar, because God said, the life of the creature is in the blood and I've given blood to make atonement for sin. Here's the key thing about Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. When Jesus died, he paid the price. When he rose from the dead, he demonstrated the price was paid. Not only was the price paid, but your future resurrection and my resurrection became expressed when Jesus rose from the dead, because the kingdom of God in its fullness all of a sudden burst into human existence. And the idea that people, you and me, we will be raised to live like Christ and with Christ forever is based on the fact he didn't just die. He died, he was buried, he rose from the dead. In fact, the New Testament emphasizes he rose. He didn't just die. He rose never to die again. And he's exalted at the right hand of the Father. And he's coming back for those who love him, who trust and follow him. And that includes you. Then he appeared to Cephas, another name for Peter. Then to the 12. After that, he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers and sisters at the same time, most of whom are living, though some have fallen asleep. This is probably written somewhere around 54, 55 AD. As best I can tell, Jesus rose from the dead in 30 AD. So he's saying 25 years later, you can still go talk to people. They saw him rise from the dead. They were with him, and you can go and investigate this for yourself. But then he goes on, and he's pressing, as I'm trying to press now. He's pressing on. Don't just make this a part of your faith. Don't like seek to be a good person, do good causes. They're good. You should be good. You should pursue good causes. But don't build your life on those things. Because let me tell you about the resurrection, Paul says. If Christ has not been raised, our preaching and teaching is useless. Like, if this isn't the center, everything else doesn't matter. And so is your faith. Like, if he didn't really rise, it's all a waste of time. We are found to be false witnesses about God, for we have testified about God that he raised Christ from the dead. Like, I've wasted my life. You've wasted your life if Jesus really did not rise from the dead. This is so precious. This is so important. It doesn't get more important than this. He goes on and says, for if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, everything we are about is futile. It's a waste of time. If Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. You're still in your sins. And if only for this life we have hope in Christ, we are of all people most to be pitied. How's that for you? This one thing is everything for who we are, what our lives are about, and where we're going. He then says this, listen, I tell you a mystery. How's it going to work? How's it going to work? When's it going to happen? I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep. We all won't stay dead. Jesus is coming back. But we will all be changed. Here's how it's going to happen. In a flash, in the twinkling of an eye at the last trumpet, in the Bible, it's like the angels are trumpeting the returning king, because that's how they heralded kings. Here comes the king. Listen to the trumpets. In the twinkling of an eye at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. So here's my life. Here's your life. Our lives are, we are living these lives that we've been given. We're enjoying things in this life that we've been given. We aspire to be more. We aspire to experience more, but we're caught in this struggle with sin. And then ultimately we're going to die. And the gospel says that is not the end. Jesus is coming back and you're going to be raised from the dead. I'm going to be raised from the dead. We're going to have new bodies, spiritual, powerful, glorious bodies to live forever and ever in the new heaven and new earth with God. And that kingdom is the ultimate kingdom that matters more than anything. So friends, here's the thing. Here's the thing. Please hear me on this. Don't settle for anything else but this at the center of who you are and how you live your life. Please. He finishes by saying these words. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Now, so far we have just talked about building our lives around this teaching. Next week we're going to talk about, we don't just trust the resurrection of Jesus, we trust and follow him. We believe in a discipleship gospel in this church, which means that we are called not to just trust his death, burial, and resurrection for when we die. We're called to trust his death, burial, and resurrection for here and now, not just then and there. For how we follow Jesus and become like Jesus and learn to care about the things Jesus cares about, especially the way we love people the way Jesus did. So I would encourage you to come back next week. Now, I got to be transparent with you. I prayed all week about, really had great clarity a couple of weeks ago on what to talk to you about this morning because this is so central and so important, but I couldn't figure out how to end things. And I kept praying about it, and then within 24 hours, three people drew me to this story that I want to draw to your attention now. See, it's a story about a professor of a small college in the western United States. His name was actually Dr. Christensen. And at this small college, they had to take a Bible class. All freshmen had to take a Bible class. And it was on the basics of Christianity. So whoever you were, you had to take it. Now, Dr. Christensen, as he taught the class, he was a genuine believer, and he really tried to impress on people the importance of what he was saying and the importance of the gospel. But he felt like more often than not, people were just, you know, they were nodding, but they didn't really get it. More often than not, it felt like it was just a drudgery to all the students. This is a class they had to take, like every other class, and they just wanted to get through it, and it really bothered him. So he had a student in the class named Steve. Now, Steve was only a freshman, but he was a godly man. He aspired to go to seminary, and he was well-liked. He was also an imposing physical specimen. He played football. He was the center of the football team. And the guy could bench press lots of weights, and he could do push-ups. He was also the best student in the class. He, like, had perfect grades in every quiz and test that he took. So one day, as the course was coming to an end, and Dr. Christensen was wanting to get through to the class, he asked Steve a strange question. He said to Steve, "How many push-ups can you do?" Well, Steve said, "Well, I do 200 push-ups every night." He goes, "Wow, that's pretty good. Do you think you could do 300? And Steve goes, "Well, I don't know. I've never done 300 at one time." "Well, do you think you could?" Dr. Christensen said. "Do you think that if you had to do 30 sets of 10 push-ups, one after the other, that you could do it?" Steve said, "Well, I'm not sure. Maybe I can. I think I could do that." He said, "Okay, good, Steve. I want you to come to class a little bit early on Friday, and I want you to sit right over here, and I'll explain what we're going to do." So the day came, and it was actually the last class for the semester. It was on a Friday, and so it was the last class of the day on a Friday before a big weekend, and all the students came in, and Dr. Christensen pulled out a box of donuts. Now, like, these were the best donuts ever. And so everybody sits down, and Dr. Christensen comes out, and he starts with Cynthia. And he says, "Cynthia, do you want to have one of these donuts?" And she says, "Yes, I'd love to have one of those donuts." And so Dr. Christensen gives Cynthia the donut, and he says to Steve, "Steve, will you do 10 push-ups so Cynthia can have this donut?" Everybody goes, "That's weird." So Cynthia takes the donut. She says, "Thank you." Then he comes to Joe. Joe, would you like one of these donuts? Joe goes, yes, sir. Dr. Christensen, I'd love to have one of those donuts. Dr. Christensen says to Steve, Steve, will you do 10 push-ups so that Joe can have this donut? And on it went, and he goes through the first aisle of the class. Steve doing 10 push-ups for every donut that everybody got. But when he gets to the second aisle, he comes up to Scott, and it's Scott's turn. Now, Scott was on the basketball team, and he was a pretty good athlete, and he's a very popular guy. And Dr. Christensen said, Scott, do you want a donut? Scott's reply was, well, I think I would, but I want to do my own push-ups. Dr. Christensen said, well, I'm sorry, Steve has to do the push-ups for you. And Scott says, well, I don't want a donut then. I want to do the push-up myself. Dr. Christensen said, look, this is my classroom, my class, my desks, my rules, my donuts. Steve, do a donut for Scott, even though he doesn't want it. So Steve did a push-up, did his 10 push-ups. Then he gets to the third row, and by now the students are, they're not happy about this situation. They're getting a little angry. Dr. Christensen gets to Jenny. Jenny, do you want a donut? Sternly, she says, I don't want a donut. Dr. Christensen says to Steve, Steve, would you do 10 more push-ups so that Jenny can have a donut that she doesn't want? Steve did 10. Jenny got the donut. Now a growing sense of uneasiness is in the room. Every student's starting to say no. And there's all these uneaten donuts being put on their desks. And each time Steve does another set of 10 push-ups, he's sweating. And you can see Dr. Christensen is going from student to student, he's sweating. The sweat and the difficulty with the push-ups continues. Finally, he gets to the end of the third row, and he's about to give out a donut, and other students hear the commotion in the hall, and they start coming in. All of a sudden, this transfer student named Jason shows up. He looks in the room. He says, hey, everybody getting donuts? I want to come in and get one. And the whole class goes, no! But Steve looks at him and says, he can have a donut. So Dr. Christensen says to Jason, do you want a donut? He says, yeah. And then he turns to Steve and says, Steve, will you do 10 push-ups so Jason can have a donut? Jason's bewildered, and people are noticing how difficult it is for Steve to keep doing these push-ups. Remember, he's never done this many before. And he comes to the last two students. They're both young women, both cheerleaders, and very popular. He comes up to Linda, the second to the last, and he says, Linda, do you want a donut? And she says, with just desperation, and I don't even know what's going on here, no, thank you. Professor Christensen quietly says, Steve, would you do 10 push-ups so that Linda can have a donut that she doesn't want? And now he's really, really struggling. That's the 34th set. And finally he comes to Susan. Susan, do you want a donut? Susan says with tears on her face, Dr. Christensen, I don't want a donut and I want to help Steve. Dr. Christensen, realizing everybody's listening and realizing what he's about to say, has tears in his eyes himself, and he says, Steve has to do the last push-ups by himself. I've given him this task. He's in charge of seeing that everyone has an opportunity for a donut, whether they want it or not. This is the last day of school. This is the last class. I took out my grade book, he says, and Steve is the only student with a perfect grade. Everyone else has failed a test, skipped a class, or offered inferior work. And Steve told me he's on the football team, and when somebody messes up in football practice, they have to do push-ups. So I told Steve that none of you could come to my party and have donuts unless Steve paid the price by doing your push-ups. He and I made a deal for your sakes. Steve, would you do that last 10 push-ups so Susan can have a donut? And very slowly, he finished and 50 push-ups before his arms buckled. Dr. Christensen then turned to the class and said, "All this semester I've tried to tell you about the gospel of Jesus Christ, how he is our Savior, how God sent him into the world to show us his love. And some of you hear me talk, and it's like the donuts you leave on your desk. My wish," he said, "is that you might understand, we all might understand the riches and the mercy that was given to us now and forever. But whether we choose or not, the price has been paid." "Wouldn't it be foolish," he said to the class, "to act like it didn't matter?" I think it's really easy, especially in Middle Tennessee, to act like, "Yeah, we get it. We get it." But do we really get it? This is the most life-changing, most important stuff for your life, for the lives of everybody you know. This, only the gospel of Jesus, answers the real core human predicament. Everything else is just sound and noise. So, brothers and sisters, please, don't let it sit there and not be appreciated by you and by me.